excited that we can celebrate the Lord Jesus today. We're gathered together as one church, but two congregations. We're the Church of Jesus Christ, represented by House of God and Emmanuel Reformed Church. And we're here to celebrate Jesus, his death and his resurrection, and the new life that we have because of Jesus. This morning is going to be an opportunity for you to share your God stories. How have you seen God at work in your life? Maybe share an unexpected blessing during the pandemic. It's also Worldwide Communion Sunday, and so we will celebrate communion with brothers and sisters in Christ from all over the planet, and that's exciting for us. Our hope, whether you're here in person in the building, or if you're worshiping with us online through the live stream, our hope is that you experience the very presence of Jesus Christ, that the goodness of God is very real to you. Now, if you're indoors here in the building, this is our first indoor worship service, and you're aware that there's some changes that have been made. Pews have been roped off with caution tape because we're trying to be cautious with the coronavirus and the spread of this virus. There are hand sanitizing stations. After worship, we're going to greet each other outdoors instead of indoors. And we're also wearing masks. We're asking everyone to wear masks during our worship service and while they're in the building. I know, this is frustrating, it's aggravating, we don't want to do it. Some of you are kind of in a place of like, hey, what's the big deal? And others of you aren't really concerned. And then a whole bunch are in between. And I want to remind us all of Romans chapter 14, verse 1. Paul writes this to the church in Rome. He can write it to us today, the church here. And he writes, accept one another without passing judgment on disputable matters. Wearing masks, social distancing, all that kind of stuff, those are disputable matters. We don't judge each other for them. We accept one another. Or in another Bible verse says, love one another just as Christ has loved you. And so we want to love each other through this pandemic. So this morning, while we're worshiping, we invite you to praise Jesus with all of your heart, soul, and strength. We're also going to love each other and give each other the space and the distance during this time. I want to read a verse for us from Revelation chapter 7, verses 9 and 10. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. We're here today to proclaim salvation belongs to our God. We're here today to celebrate the salvation that we have because of Jesus Christ. We're doing this on the first day of the week because it is the day that Jesus arose from the dead. He conquered death and the grave. He conquered sin. He's forgiven us. And we have a new status, new life. So we're celebrating all of that. Today we're also celebrating Worldwide Communion Sunday. And it's not just us here in Grand Rapids doing it. It's not just us here in America doing it. Just like we read in Revelation chapter 7, we're doing it with a multitude of brothers and sisters in Christ from all over North America, Central America, South America, Africa, Europe, Asia, Australia, New Zealand, the whole planet. We are gathering together to celebrate Jesus. And we invite you to celebrate Jesus with us. It is a beautiful day. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Amen.
Pastor Brian said, let us rejoice and be glad in this day which the Lord has made. So I wonder if we could just start the day off by just celebrating God. Thank you, Lord. Oh God, we thank you for this this day that you have made. We rejoice and we're glad in it. We celebrate you. Hallelujah. We celebrate you. That's our reason for being here today, God. We're excited about your work, your activity in our lives. We're excited about what you're doing in us, personally and individually and collectively. We're excited about your love, your grace, your power, your redemption, God, your faithfulness towards us, your mercy, your goodness, your kindness. God, we're just excited about you today. So we lift our voices, we lift our hands, we clap our hands, we sing songs of praise. God, we celebrate you. Hallelujah. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. All right, God bless you. Now, you just heard, you may be seated. You heard from Pastor Brian via video, but I think we're going to get a chance to hear from him live. Is it on? Testing.
Hey, Pastor Sam, can you hear me?
Yeah, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
How you doing, buddy?
I'm doing great. I'm in Canada.
I'm not sure if that's great or not. Everybody's applauding. Everybody's applauding. Everybody's applauding. Celebrating you.
Well, it's so great to be with you this morning. Glad that we're able to celebrate Jesus together. I'm doing it by myself in quarantine this morning. But I'm just grateful to God that I have this place to quarantine. It's a little chilly here in Canada.
Same here. A little chilly here too.
I understand you had a big special day yesterday.
I did. It was a beautiful experience. I'll have to tell you all about it when you get back.
All right, hear it.
Everything went really well, and we managed to get the place back into condition for us to worship together today. So it was a great time.
All right, yeah. If you didn't know, Pastor Sam's daughter, Martise, got married yesterday to her fiancé, Bernard. So that's pretty exciting.
Yeah. Pastor Brian, you mentioned that you're there alone in quarantine. But we want you to know you're not alone. Of course, you know the presence of God is there, and our hearts are there with you as well. So you're missed. You're missed dearly. Want you to know that.
And well, thank you.
We're going to celebrate as if you're here with us.
All right. Well, I miss each and every one of you. I so wish I could be there with you all today. Yeah, it's Worldwide Communion Sunday, and that's just so exciting that we can celebrate communion that way. And you have one brother over here celebrating communion with you today in Canada. I'm pretty sure there's at least a couple other Christians in Canada who are going to do it with you as well. But you got me anyways, for sure.
So you're representing Canada. Great. All right.
I'll represent.
All right. Well, bless you. It's great to see you and hear from you. And just know that you love. And we're looking forward to you getting back safely.
All right. Well, thank you. Blessings upon all of you. You're in my hearts and prayers. Glad that we could be together this morning.
God bless you, friend.
You as well.
This is a celebration, so we want you to feel free. I know this is a little weird with masks on, but we're spaced down so you can feel free to express yourself as we celebrate the Lord.
Well, we'd ask you to rise for singing. For many of us, this has been a song of celebration, a song of great faith, and I am hoping this morning, because we are kind of doing things new, so to speak, because we're back together. I don't think that our worship stopped. I think we did it in different ways, but I think when we come back, this root, this song that has been ingrained, maybe you'll experience it in a new way. Maybe you'll have a new insight. Maybe you will worship in a new way. But I just invite you to be open to your knowledge of these words. And if they're brand new to you, may they just wash over you, but may all things be about the one who we celebrate as we sing, "How great thou art." How great you are is what we're saying. How great you are.
I'm coming back.
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise you.
Together.
this is a move, and so just go right back to where you were.
Hallelujah.
Oh,
we need your move.
Come move in this place.
Yes, move in this place.
Come move in this place.
Oh, move in this place.
Come move in this place.
Your move in this place.
Good morning, everyone. So glad to be back in the house. The word that the Lord has given me is that He is with us. And not only is He with us, but He is for us. And that He's doing a new thing. I'm sure we all can see that He's doing a new thing. He is digging new wells. You guys know when they go over and they dig new wells in different countries, they have to dig deep. Deep, deep, deep. The deep calls into the deep. God is doing a new well in this house, and He's digging deep. And He's doing it, and it's not by the hands of man. This well that He's digging, our fingerprints are on it. This is a God thing. He's doing it. And when the it's new water, it's fresh water. Have you ever seen when they dig wells and then there's fresh water and they're pumping and they're pumping and they're pumping and all of a sudden there's fresh water, clean water. That represents the Holy Spirit. There's a freshening of the Holy Spirit that God is doing in this place. There's a new move, new well, fresh water. So Let's all gather around the well so that we can be saturated with the gift of the Holy Spirit, because it's a fresh thing, a new thing that God is doing. And he's with us, he loves us, and he's for us. In Jesus' name.
Yes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for that word. Thank you, Gloria and Deb and the worship team, Sue and Chuck, for leading us in worship. Anybody here besides me sense God's presence?
Hallelujah.
Sometimes I think we're waiting for him to kind of like mysteriously walk through the door or through the wall. But he's here. One of the ways I know he's here is because he's in us. And also he assured us that he would be here when we gathered together in his name. So he is here. And I want to invite us on this first Sunday of October, first Sunday back in our building, to engage him. In spite of the restrictions. You guys look beautiful, by the way, in your mask. Never look better. I won't even say that. But for people like Della, the mask is helping him out, you know. I just say that about him. Yes, yeah. But it's a joy and a pleasure to be here together in his presence. And this pleases God. Scripture says, oh, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. And here we are together in the presence of God. This honors him. It pleases him. And today, as has already been pointed out, is Worldwide Communion Day. It's a day of celebrating. And so our theme for today, Pastor Brian and I decided that we would just focus on celebrating God today. I want to read a passage. Actually, Prophet Della read it earlier, but I want to just revisit that. Psalms 108, and I'm going to read it. I think it's in the NIV on the screen, but I'm going to just read the, what is it? It's the same thing. Okay, King James, good. Oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness and for his wondrous works to the children of men. So I want to look at that verse for a few minutes, but I want to start at the beginning of that psalm. This is a psalm that's offered by David, and many of the scholars and commentators agree that it's a song of penitence by David. It's a song that reflects on what God had done for Israel in terms of bringing them out of bondage, but also it's a song that reflects on what God had done specifically for David in after he had committed a grievous sin in terms of getting involved with Bathsheba, Uriah's wife, and as a result, she got pregnant, and he had her husband sent to the front line and killed in battle. So, you know, he had done just a whole lot of wrong things in that scenario. And the prophet David came to him and challenged him on it. And he repented. That's the beautiful thing about David. He was not flawless. He was far from flawless. But scripture says he was a man after God's heart. And I think part of that has to do with the fact that he was repentant. He didn't deny his wrongdoing. He didn't deny his sin. He owned it. And you read Psalms 51, you see him crying out to God, creating a clean heart. Renew with me a right spirit. He's asking God to search him. And God forgave him. God restored him. And so David, in this song, you see him reflecting on that and celebrating restoration. And he starts in verse 1. And by the way, Psalms, these were song. Like we, like the worship team led us in songs. These would be song during their gatherings in that day. And so he starts off by saying, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and for his mercy endureth forever." And David is challenging the congregation to reflect on the goodness of God. He's reminding them, you'll see in subsequent verses, that he kind of outlines some of what God had done. And he's challenging them to reflect on God's goodness. So your thanks, the measure to of the degree to which you are thankful, is directly connected to what God has done, to your perception of who he is. And he refers to him as the Lord, the self-existent one. So he's reminding him, you're offering thanks not to a human being. You're not celebrating me, but the Lord, your creator, the one who has brought you out of Egypt, the one who led you through the wilderness. This is David's conversation with the folk that were in the gathering during his day. He said, reflect on the Lord, the creator, the one who caused the birds to sing, the sun to shine, the one who spoke when there was nothing and universe came into existence. That's who you're giving thanks to, David says. And I think that was his conversation with the Hebrew gathering, but I would like to echo the same thing to us today. We didn't gather for each other, believe it or not. Now it's good that we're here together, and there's benefit in that. But our primary reason for being here is the Lord. One of the lines in one of the songs that the worship team sung earlier was, "We are here for you." Did I get that right? Did that register to anybody? You didn't come for me today. I'm glad to see you, but I'm not here for you.
All right.
You are here for the Lord.
Yeah.
Who is the Lord in your life? Because their celebration was predicated on who the Lord was to them. And you know what? I've seen celebrations. I've watched people respond, including me, to different personalities, depending on how we perceive that person determines how we respond to their presence. You walk into a courtroom, you're seated. But when the judge walks in or the magistrate walks in, you stand. Because our perception is they represent authority. They represent law. So we stand. The presence of the Lord, if we stand for the judge, what should our response be to his presence? I see somebody's, one person's getting it. When you discern that you're in God's presence, how do you respond? prostrate earlier? Sometimes we get distracted by the routine of what we do. When we come together, it becomes kind of routine, becomes ritual, ritualistic, religious even, if you will, until we forget the whole reason why we're doing it. The songs you sing, they're not to me. It's to the Lord. He's the audience. And so with that in mind, I respond accordingly. When I've seen scenarios when the president of the United States entered the room where the rest of the folk are, they stand. There's applause. Rightfully so. Because he's the president. But if we stand for him and we applaud him and we stand for the judge, what should we do when we recognize the presence of God? Does he want anything?
Yeah.
And see, it doesn't matter your personality when the president walks in or you're in the courtroom and the judge walks in. It doesn't matter whether you're an extrovert or an introvert. It doesn't matter whether you're quiet and sort of reserved or whether you're like me and you're just loud. You respond to the person. If you're quiet or loud, when the president walks in, you stand and clap. If you're introvert or an extrovert, when the judge walks in, you stand. What does God deserve when we desire his presence? It's not about my personality. It's about who's in the room. Does this make any sense to anybody?
Yes.
And the psalmist, let me jump to the main verse here, so I want to get to. Actually, the next verse is interesting. He says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Those he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. What are you saying, David? In the first verse, he says, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he's good. And his mercy, his kindness is eternal, it's everlasting. He never changes his disposition towards us. Even though we mess up, he still loves us. Even though we fall out with each other, he still loves us. Even though we get it wrong. Even though sometimes we refuse to give him praise and the honor he deserves, he still loves us. And David says in the second verse, he says, I don't expect everyone to celebrate God. But the redeemed, those who have been impacted by him, those who have experienced the effect of his love, his grace, his redemption, his power. He said, you should say something. People who don't know God like you know him, don't expect them to stand. Don't expect them to bow. Don't expect them to prostrate. Don't expect them to sing. But those of us who've experienced God, you see him working in your life. You see Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let me jump down to the... I wasn't really supposed to preach today. I'm sorry. Verse 6, I need to just mention this. He talks about what God had done for them and how they wandered in the wilderness. He brought about their souls were hungry, thirsty, and felt like they were going to faint. In verse 6, he says, and then they cried. He says, this is what they did, the people that he served in that day. They cried unto the Lord in their trouble. This is why David said you need to celebrate. Has anybody been in a place where you've cried out to God? Yes. And by the way, trouble, the term trouble is translated tight place. Yes. Anybody been in any tight spaces?
Yes.
Hard places? Yeah. Difficult experiences? I think COVID has kind of put us all in that to some degree or another. But in those tight places, they cried out unto the Lord. And there's something about a tight place that causes your prayer to go from acute petition to a cry. In those tight places, you really don't have the energy for the formalities. It's like, God, I need you. Where are you, God? If you don't show up, I'm done.
Yes.
They cried. And David said, he delivered. He delivered them out of their distresses.
Amen.
Let me jump to the last verse and we'll be done. Oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness and his wondrous works toward the children of men. Praise in this text, in the original language, refers to the lifting or the extending of hands. It's a Hebrew term, yadah, and it's lifting hands. Now there are several Hebrew phrases, terms that are translated in praise, and they have different meanings. Yadah is lifting hands, there's tehillah, which has to do with singing. There's others that have to do with shouting. There's others that have to do with dancing. Anybody, did you all know God likes to dance? I got to dance with my daughter yesterday. And she choreographed this dance for us, this father-daughter dance that stretched me, to say the least. I moved parts of me that I didn't know I could move. And it was like my body was saying, okay, what are we doing? but it was delightful. It was fun. And I got to dance with her. I got to hold in my arms and we danced. And Bible says that he dances over us. So there's words, Hebrew words for praise that mean to dance, to shout, lift your hands, to sing, to prostrate. And when you look at this, you get the idea that they were very animated in their expression of worship to God. They use their hands, they use their feet. Now I'm not making this up. You can study it, read it, you're all for yourself. But they were very expressive. They understood something about God. And you might ask a question, okay, well, maybe that was just a cultural thing. Maybe they were just, you know, animated people. Perhaps. But is it possible that they had an understanding of who God is and an depth of experience with God, that pulled things out of him. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's kind of like my granddaughter, you all haven't met her, someday you will. She's only 11 months old. But when she sees me now, she hasn't always done this, but now when she sees me, she gets this big grin and she gets to kicking her legs and she's like, she can't say Papa, but you know that's what she's saying. It's because initially, there was no response from her. In fact, it was kind of like this, because she didn't know me. But the more time I spent with her, my wife and I, the more she began to trust and get to know me and love me. And now when she sees us, she gets excited. When she sees her parents, oh, she's over the top. It, because of the relationship, it pulls something out of her. And this isn't just an Old Testament idea. When Jesus entered the city of Jerusalem, they were celebrating him, man. They were laying their clothes on the floor, coats on the ground for him to parade over, palm trees, and they were crying out. They were dancing and singing. And then there were those religious people who were wanting to shut it down and say, okay, you know, this is too much noise. And Jesus' response was, if you silence them, the rocks will replace them and cry out. In other words, what you see happening is a normal response when the king enters. If you don't praise me, nature will. That's what Jesus was saying. Because that's the normal response when the king of glory enters, just like the normal response to when the judge enters the courtroom, you stand. When the king of glory enters, the normal response is to express him, express your love for him with your whole being. So David said this, with my whole heart, God, will I praise you. With my total, with all of me. So it wasn't cultural, it was relational. Does this make sense to anybody?
Yes.
Now let me finish. Let me wrap this up here. He says, "Oh, that they would praise God for His wonderful works." In other words, there's some things that only God can do in your life. Listen, and you know this. There's some moments, some situations that only God could have worked out.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm sure you can mark those moments when you didn't know what to do. And God showed up in that moment. This is who we're talking about, folks. We're talking about a God who loves us enough to show up in our lives. We're not talking about religion here. We're not talking about tradition here. We're talking about our Father. Just like my granddaughter is excited to see her parents, and she kicks and she says all kind of ooh, cuckoo cars, and throws her hands up because she sees her mom and her dad. How do we respond when our dad shows up? Notice, David says, oh, that men would praise him. Oh, you things. For David, this wasn't a simple request. It was a passionate, urgent exhortation. He was like, oh, we've got to praise God. He's been that good. Oh, he healed him. You need to praise him. Oh, he's delivered you. You need to express love to him. Oh, he got you out of that situation. We need to praise God. All that it would praise him. All that we would recognize he's here. All that we would deserve that this isn't about man. This is about God. Give me a moment. I think some of you get it. This isn't about me. I get nothing out of this. It's about you. It's about us and our Father. We bring nothing to the table.
All right.
We accept our brokenness. And I hope that we won't allow our pride or our insecurities or our shame or anything to interfere with giving God what he deserves. Reflect on what he's done in your life.
Right.
I don't want you to respond because I'm asking you to. It's that superficial. It's religious. It can't be about me. It has to be about you and God. So for a moment, just reflect on his goodness in your life. Think about it, because their expression to God was based upon his involvement in their life. What has he done for you? Who is he to you? What value does he hold? Seconds or so. I want to invite you usual time, wearing masks, social distancing. Perhaps an unusual time necessitates an unusual praise. I want to invite you, just as you would for the judge and the president, give them the respect and honor that they deserve when they enter the room. I want you to give God what he deserves from you based upon who he is in your life. Don't worry about what everybody else is doing. This isn't about anybody else. This is about you and God. From the depths of your soul, based upon your perception of who he is to you, for the next 35 seconds or so, just give him praise that he deserves. Come on, people of God.
Hallelujah. We love you, Lord.
Yes, come on. This is just release it to him. Come on, release it to him. He wants to hear from you. He wants to hear from you. This is a celebration. Come on, celebrate him. Celebrate him in this moment. 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 If he's Lord of all, celebrate him like he's Lord of all. If he means everything to you, celebrate him like he means everything to you. If he's the Lord of your life, celebrate him like he's the Lord of your life. If he is your Father, celebrate him like he's your Father. Father, we bless you. Come on, bless him. Come on, bless him. Bless him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Make a choice for the Lord and to the Lord among the people. Celebrate him with gladness. Come before his presence with thanksgiving. God, we celebrate you. We celebrate you, Lord. We magnify you. We exalt you, O God. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. You are good, God. And your mercy endures forever. We bless your name. Why you praise him like you do. So for the next few moments, we want to give space for you to come and share. You can be seated. Your story. Come on, don't be afraid. Don't be shy. Amen. Come on, friend. There we are.
Nice, Fred. As most of you know, I've been dealing with a back injury for 40 years. And in 1997, I really hurt my back and had 5 surgeries in less than a year. And I had to give up golf, which I really loved. Never thought I'd be able to go back to it. 2 years ago, my doctor found this device to put in my back that would help me get rid of the pain, be about 90% pain-free. And before he put the 2 leads into my spine, but where I had the injury, he asked me what I wanted to do. And I said, I'd like to golf again. So what he did was he put an extra loop so that I could swing. So Tom Petty and I started talking a year ago about going out. Didn't work out last year, this year it did. I had no idea if I could even swing. I had no idea if I'd have pain. Tom and I went out, I had no pain.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
I was floored, because honestly I thought, wait till the night, I'm going to be in bad shape. And I was, but it was because of my hips, because I had musings for a while. And I got the bug to play. And I've gone out 6 or 7 times before. Tom's been teaching me some stuff. Bruce Deming's been teaching me stuff. And I'm having a ball. And my whole thing was, if I can golf, I don't care what I shoot, just to go out there and do it. Now that's gone to the wayside. Now I don't care about what I shoot. But what I figured was, and I told some of you people, that it only took me 8 back operations, a quadruple bypass heart surgery, to finally cure my slice. So I'm having a ball.
Yeah, that's the gospel. You said 8 back surgeries and a quadruple bypass. And he's golfing.
Awesome.
I tell you what, man, heaven gets excited over stuff like that. Anybody else got a story to tell?
Hello again. Well, my story is, during Corona, I have known God as Jehovah Jireh, my provider. I have not wanted for anything, and I know in His Word it says, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging, nor their seed begging bread. I haven't wanted for anything. God has been so faithful and so good. While we were off, I received a raise. While we were off, my job normally does not cover our insurance for the summer. I had insurance for the whole summer. Checks in the mail, and it's not about the money, it's about His faithfulness. While other people are, you know, frantic and anxious and not knowing where it's coming from, He's so faithful to me. So faithful, like no lack in the cabinets, no lack on my car payment, no lack in the rent, no lack in my tithes and offering, like no lack. So I have known God through this season of Corona as Jehovah Jireh. My for my. So I just want to share that.
So he heals and he provides. Can anybody else say anything about it?
I'll be brief because there were a lot of details, but some of you here already know about them from both congregations. From the church group text, there were some prayers going forth. And my grandmother, Barbara Jones, she got onto the Zoom call right before we started meeting in the parking lot and met Pastor Sam and a number of you, or saw face to face. And she is 84 still, I believe, but she, few weeks ago, a month ago, I went straight from church to her house. I just felt the leading to go and fellowship with her or be there. And I happened to observe things that were wrong with her diet, with what my stepdad was doing, things that were a little dangerous, and then a procedure she'd had that was kind of pushed on her by a doctor that had made her worse. But the next morning, symptoms she was having from something else developed into what I thought was a stroke, and one of her eyes looked like it was all blood, and she couldn't speak. We got her to the hospital, and then it's just been just confusion ever since. They couldn't diagnose it. They figured it was maybe brain cancer instead, but part of her brain area is gone, and she's speaking now. She's not completely coherent, but my sister that second week told us, she was there in the hospital with her, and she read one of my grandma's favorite songs to her, Psalm 23, and left blanks the second time, you know, the second day she read it, and my grandmother filled in all the blanks. So her spirit's strong, her mind was clear, but something about the, you know, we're praying for Thelma's mother, Beverly. I don't know what the condition is, but we're seeing some similar symptoms, so I'm believing for God to do the same. But my grandmother is in outpatient therapy now. We're hoping for her to come home, and the good news is that while they hadn't diagnosed her yet, they're thinking that it's simply probably just medication she was on for blood pressure or something else that caused a brain bleed. So there may be nothing absolutely wrong with her. And if there is, I'm praising God that by Jesus' stripes she's healed anyway, and so is God. Hallelujah! Praise you, Lord!
God heals, he's faithful, and he speaks. And I think for the last year, especially during Corona, so for me, if you want to hear my story, I'll share it. But years ago, God spoke a calling into my life, a prophetic calling.
Yes.
And it's been a journey over the last years of accepting that and understanding what that has been. But I can stand here and claim that calling and gift now, even though I still doubt. But what I've seen over this last year is my doubts are when I hear words, doubting the words, and whether God is, those are God or not. And I can say that over the last year during Corona, I have seen God fulfilling and beginning to fulfill some of those words. And it just, it's exciting. I'm excited to see us worshiping together. And one of the things, I'm shaking. One of the words that God just has continually brought to me is just, we need to get back to him. It's all about him. It's all about him, and this church needs to be relying on him and look, having him lead us. And anyway, I want to encourage you all to let you know, those who maybe are part of leadership, that is happening. God is changing hearts and working and bringing the leadership in this church to him, to follow him. The elders, the staff, the deacons, they are on their knees praying for God to lead. And I just want to share Psalm 127. Unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the guards stand a watch in vain. In vain you rise up early and stay up late, toiling for food to eat, for he grants sleep to those he loves. We aren't toiling anymore. I mean, we're not perfect, but I can say that we are looking to God.
Yeah.
We aren't trying to lead our way. We aren't trying to come up with all these things and try and do our own things. I can see where the leadership is allowing God to lead. So in those times, when we allow Him to, we can rest. He provides rest. We don't have to be anxious. We don't have to feel overwhelmed. We don't have to feel burnt out. We rest in Him, and He will lead the way. And when He does, it will be so exciting. It already is. I'm so excited. And it's all for His glory. It's not anything we are doing. We are doing nothing. There's nothing we are doing. We are following what He is doing. We are saying, okay, God, this is weird. House of God, man, they're a little, their culture is animated. But it's all God. It's all God. And I know my roots are going so much deeper in my foundation of Christ. And I love it. So.
The prayer that I have is that God is continually faithful. He continues to make a way. He continues to bless us. He continues to strengthen us. He continues to walk with us and let us know that I haven't left him, still there. You know, when I think about, you know, my finances and my past and just what I'm going through, I think about no matter how bad things are, how bad things get, when you recognize God, you need to say something because you're not doing it on your own. You know, I know it's a whole lot of times where I feel like I don't have everything I want. I don't have everything I think I should have. I don't have everything the next person has. But God has been faithful. He keeps a roof over my head. He blessed me to always have something to eat. I get a chance to get out and do things. And, you know, I go out and enjoy myself. I have a good time. And I know all the stuff that I'm doing or whatever, it's all because of God. You know, without Him or whatever, it wouldn't be nearly the stuff going on in my life that's going on. I recently took a vacation and went to Vegas, and you know, I had never been, so I hadn't even planned on going. In fact, it wasn't even my idea to go. My daughter had booked the trip or whatever and called us up and told us, you know, we're going to Vegas. And I was thinking, you know, Lord, I don't have that kind of finance. I don't have money where I can just get up and go across the country or whatever. But praise God, I went. You know, He made a way. He found a way. He gave her a mind to pay for it so I could still do it. I asked her if I had to pay her. I will tell you that. She didn't just pay for everything. But at the same time, God is still making a way. He's still doing things. You know? It's not just what I have. He's taking what I got and stretching it, making it go places, do stuff. You know, so understand God is faithful. God is real. Understand that when you're doing a lot of stuff that you don't even understand how you're doing it, you know that's God doing that. That ain't you doing that. So give Him the praise. You know, acknowledge God. Let Him know that we see you. We know that you. We know you there. Because I know God just keeps on doing great things for me. And I just want you to just praise God like He's really doing something in your life because He's helping you. You know, you may not see how He's putting it all together, but the thing that's working out, that's God doing that. Just pray with me and continue to bless God.
Most of you know that Thelma and I were blessed with a grandbaby a couple weeks ago. Pastor Ryan sent this text to me the other day, or an email with Psalm 128 in it. May the Lord bless you from Zion all the days of your life. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem, and may you live to see your children's children. peace be upon Israel. As many of you know, this was a risky pregnancy and a risky delivery. And so we are just thankful for God's blessing for a healthy baby boy and the joy in our lives. Thank you.
Welcome to the I know that joy. Come on, Fred.
As you know, I spent my mom was in the hospital yesterday. Got a call that she had slurred voice. And it was the trouble of getting from her head to her mouth. When I walked into emergency, she was very happy and cheerful, but still very garbled. By the end of the day, she was exhausted from everybody asking her questions and doing all these tests, and just off she went. But she'll be in there for about 2 or 3 more days. They're doing tests to see what's going on, what's this about. It may be in connection with dementia, which she hasn't officially been diagnosed with. But I just thank you for all your prayers and your just being with me and Scott and Lydia too, because she helped out yesterday because I was supposed to do stuff around the house. But I just thank you for all your prayers and your helps. I got a message probably 3 weeks ago when this was being planned. And Pastor wanted me to report on the $10 challenge. And that is something that is so celebrated, you know, that's something that we celebrate as a church, as a group. And it's just so wonderful that you can stand to somebody and say, here, this is for you and your organization, or this is for you to take care of some things. I split it, I got $100 through the Benevolence Fund or something like that. And I gave, I think it was $60 to the Friendship Center because they were collecting things. The other $40 I gave to my granddaughter's school so that they could get books for the children during the summer. And I am so blessed that Gloria can teach my granddaughter's music. So it's a real sweet, sweet thing.
Anybody else?
Well, I have a $10/$100 story as well. Took the money, I don't even know when it was, I think it was May or so. A parent from our school called and said, hey, there's a school that we play basketball, and they're trying to raise money because they have no athletic funds, things like that. They're collecting pop cans. They said, I'd like to donate the pop cans, we're going to help coordinate it. So I said, well, that's a great idea. So I did that, took the $100 challenge, and presented them a check and a bag of pop cans, and they had, I don't know, they probably filled a trailer full of pop cans, I bet. I'm curious to know what they raised, and which is cool. So this is from our church, and we play in basketball, but, you know, it's just a gift from our parents to you, and they're like, wow, that's, you know, awesome. So just an easy way, opportunity presented itself, and so that was my $10/$100 challenge. Also, as most of you know, I work at Gordon Food Service. Well, the pandemic has really hit us hard with restaurants that we supply, healthcare education we supply, a lot of that was shut down. Our sales dropped by almost half for a period of time. I lost half my team because of just the business downturn and things like that. You know, I'm thankful that I kept my job. God is, kind of said, Jehovah Jireh. You know, God's provided me to keep working, sometimes too much at times. But, you know, I'm thankful that I'm able to do that. And some of you don't know this, I've been actually working here for the past 6 months. I asked the pastor, like, hey, you got a couple offices? I can't work at the office. My wife loves me, but I don't know if she wants to see me all the time, like working at home and at night. So I said, yeah, that's, you know, I said, okay, I'll be a little while, you know, and it's 26, 27 weeks later, and I'm still hanging out here. But it's been a blessing that, you know, Pastor and I can talk and able to see you know, some of you more, coming in for different things, and that's been, you know, fun to do. I've earned my keep. I've turned about 30, changed about 30 light bulbs, so I have been working a little bit, you know. I open the door once in a while, and now the pastor's gone, it's just me and Candace. Well, a prayer request, Candace has a concussion. And so she's out at least a week, maybe longer. So that's one prayer request for Candace, that she heals up. So now I'm the only one here running the show. But that's okay. I'm just glad, you know, God provided me time to be here so that I can be here and open the door and just do those little things. And so, you know, as some people said, God is here even when we don't think or don't expect or don't know. Yes. And he's with us. So that's a couple of my stories.
Morning, I also received the note about sharing the $10 challenge, which was $100, and then I had others add to it. And this was during the shutdown time, of course. At the school that Thelma was speaking about, it's Alpine Elementary. Kind of interesting how God weaves people through your life, and I didn't really look at it until it was 1, 2, 3, and all the weavings of people that I've known through education, mainly kids. I had a parent. Their mom's name is Angie, and the little boy's name was Jaden. And Jaden was a special needs kid, and I bet it was 4 years ago, and he was on spring break with his dad. His dad was a trucker. And for whatever reason, crossing the street, Jaden ran out, and he was killed. And so it was this huge, horrible thing at our school, as you can imagine. I sang the funeral, and then during this virus time, Angela, the mom, her dad died, and they are a very high needs family in every way that you can think. And so she was out asking for money for the funeral and things like that. And then it wasn't long after that that a previous student of mine, her name is Tyler, and I have her son and her daughter currently, because I've been there so long, and her mom passed away. And it wasn't necessarily corona related, but I don't think it was ruled out either. And she was on at the very next 2 or 3 days later, and she was asking money for mom's funeral. And then a boy that I have currently, little fourth grade boy, sweetest little group, I guess he's fifth grade now. They came from Mexico, and grandpa brought his daughter, mom, and then the 2 or 3 kids. And he got sicker and sicker and sicker, but he couldn't. He's the breadwinner for the family. So instead of going to healthcare and getting whatever he needed, he kept going to work because he had a factory job. And of course, he did pass away of corona. And so that left mom and kids who are not legal, and the father figure, the dad, is gone. So they were also asking for funeral expenses all at the same time. And so they were all through my school connections, so I took the money from here, and I put it out to the school community and a little bit more, and I gave a little bit more to Axel's family right now because it was such a transition with the young families, but then I also gave to the other people who needed the funerals and said it was a blessing from the Manuel Church and hope it would honor their loved one, etc. So just to tell you where that money went and kind of those relationships that you don't know. I try to be, that love that these families need, but then to be able to reach back, oh my gosh, the one girl, I probably had her 20 years ago. So to be able to reach back and still have those connections and that type of thing. So it's just to show you, you know, thank you to the church for that money and how it was used to benefit families who were in an upheaval of their lives, a grief process, so with no idea where they were going next. Thanks.
The $10 challenge, I think, is just an incredible thing that God uses. And sometimes, you know, we're part of stuff, but we don't know how God is using it. We just kind of, this is what we do, you know, it's the thing we do at church, but it's changing lives, it's impacting folk in their worst moments. And so you need to know that you're not just doing something, you're partnering with God in your giving, and he's impacting lives. So that is to be celebrated, Emmanuel. That makes sense? Now, we're running out of time, but perhaps some some of you can't walk and or don't feel like walking. Again? I saw your hands. Is this a video or is it live?
I wish I could be here with you today, but greetings to you from the booming metropolis of Pufferlaw, Ontario, Canada. Pufferlaw makes Caledonia look like a big city. So I'm kind of in the middle of nowhere here. So yes, I'm quarantining in Canada for the next 2 weeks. But I want to give glory to God. I want to give glory and gratitude to God for two blessings that He's shown to my family, to myself in the last month or so. And I want to give glory to God for that. First of all, is our congregation. I am so glad and blessed to be part of such a loving, understanding, compassionate, supportive, caring congregation. You may not be aware of all the details, but the Canadian-US border has been closed since March. And in order for us to go back to Canada, there's been a 2-week quarantine in place. So you cross the border into Canada, and for 14 days you have to quarantine away from people for 2 weeks. And that's just been a barrier for our family to go back and visit our extended family in Canada. But over the summer months, my dad has not been doing well. He turns 93 in November, and we're just starting to think we need to get back to see him. And so, the Board of Elders at a meeting in the beginning of September, they said that they'd support me being gone for 3 weeks to go back to Canada to visit family. And that was just astounding. That level of care, understanding, compassion, I'm so grateful to have elders that are that supportive and understanding and loving and compassionate. And a congregation that also, you know, is the same way. So I give glory and gratitude to God for that kind of support from the leaders and congregation of our church. You guys are amazing. And I thank God for each of you. I thank each of you for this support. And especially the elders, you know, they brought it up. They asked, how can we support you? How can we send you off? And that was so life-giving to me. So thank you. Thank you. So that's one way I want to give glory and gratitude to God. And the other is for this place of quarantine. We have friends in Canada who have a cottage, and they said if we need to quarantine, we can use it. But the earliest it was available was in November because they rented out. And then when my dad fell and broke all those bones at the beginning of September, I was just like, I don't know how he's going to recover from that. I don't know how he's going to heal from that. And so we just have the sense we need to go earlier, or at least I needed to go earlier. So for 2 days, Jocelyn and I, we were scrambling, checking all kinds of different options for how we can quarantine in Canada, where we can do it, because we can't afford to stay in a hotel for 2 weeks straight, and that just would not be fun at all. So I remember one afternoon praying and saying, God, thank you for a place to quarantine in November. And that's when I'll go. And if you want me to go earlier than that, then you need to provide a place to quarantine for 2 weeks, because I can't, we can't. We've tried, we can't pull this together. So that was in the afternoon. That night at 10 o'clock, Jocelyn's dad called and said, hey Jocelyn, I'm over at your cousin Mark's house, and Mark wants to talk to Brian. So Jocelyn gives me the phone, her dad gives Mark the phone, and we're talking. I've only met Mark once, and he's a pastor in Southern Ontario. He says, hey Brian, I heard about your dad, I heard you need to come back, I heard the need for a place to quarantine. I want you to know that I'm the chairman of the board of a Christian camp in Ontario, and we have a pastor's cottage that we allow pastors to use for retreat purposes for free, and I'd like to make that available for you for 2 weeks.
Yes.
Expected, God provided a place to quarantine.
Hallelujah.
Unbelievable. We weren't expecting it at all. I was kind of expecting to not go until November. But God knew our needs. And he provides for all of our needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And so that's why I want to give glory to God that he was at work in Jocelyn's dad to bring it up with his nephew. God is at work in Mark to say, yes, we'll do this. For the camp staff here at Riverview, they've been very accommodating and supportive of me coming here. And so on this morning of worship, where we're celebrating God, celebrating Jesus Christ, celebrating the gift of life that we have because of Jesus, I want to give glory to God. He did it. He did it. So glad to be a part of our church family. So glad that God provided this place of quarantine. Yeah, he's a good God. He's a good God. I wish I could be there in person with you to celebrate Jesus, to celebrate Worldwide Communion Sunday with you. But I will be here in quarantine in Pefferla, and I am celebrating Jesus right now with you. I love each of you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your support. May Jesus be so real and evident in your life today. Let's celebrate Jesus.
I saw a couple of hands that couldn't walk or didn't feel up to walking that wanted to share a story. Did I or didn't I? I didn't see any hands? Huh? Oh, you were pointing to it. Okay, all right. I'm sorry. Well, it is Worldwide Communion Day, so, pardon me, we're going to join the rest of the world and celebrate death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord in communion. So the elders, if you would come at this time, lead us in both spaces, both congregations. And so as you know, because of the impact of the virus, we're doing things a little differently, but same results. anybody ever heard of Tim Hawkins?
Yeah.
He does a routine about this that you gotta see. It's hilarious. But anyways, let me just pray and then we're gonna serve you. Father, thank you for your death, burial, and resurrection. Thank you for the price you paid for our redemption. We're here today and we have God's stories, praise reports, celebrating what you've done in our lives, and we're grateful. As we commune, you said, as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of you. So as we commune today, God, we're reflecting on what you've done for us. In Jesus' name, amen. So if you each will take a moment. Thank you. Christ that was shed for us. We take it at this time. Thank you, Lord. The wine represents the blood of the New Testament that was offered for our redemption, the blood of Jesus, our Lord. Let me take it in this time. Thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you. Is anybody grateful for the blood? Is anybody grateful for the price that Jesus paid? Just give him praise in this moment right here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Express your gratitude right here in this moment. We thank you, O God, for the blood. We thank you, O God, for the offering of your body for our redemption. We wouldn't be here with a God's story had it not been for the sacrifice that you made. Thank you that you gave your life. No one took it, but you laid it down. And you were thinking of us when they were driving those spikes into your wrist. God, you had us on your mind. When they pierced you in your side, you had us on your mind. When they whipped you and they tore the flesh off of your skin, off of your body, God, you had us on your mind. When they plucked your beard and spat in your face, you had us on your mind. When they raised that cross and you hung there, you bled and died, you were thinking of us. Nobody's loved us like that. Thank you for loving us the way that you do. In Jesus' name.
We are going to close with my friends, May You Grow in Grace. Please stand if you are able. Normally this would be a time that we would reach across the aisles and connect ourselves. We will not do that today, but you may express your unity with Christ instead.
I'm worthy. I'm worthy.
asking that you would fellowship outside in the parking lot as an effort to practice, just safety and caring for one another. And at this time, you dismiss, go in peace, and may the blessings of the Lord be upon you throughout this week. God bless you.